I'm Matthew Weiner. I hope your phones are off. I am here to have a casual conversation, after which there will be three questions entertained from the audience. They are not Morris's rules to business. And I'm thrilled to sit here and talk about this beautiful movie with its director and writer, David O. Russell.
Thank you. So first, I want to thank everybody for coming out. Thank everybody for coming out. And I want to thank Matt Weiner, one of my heroes, for being here.
Okay. Thank you. I'm thrilled that you asked me. And I love this movie, and we're both such casual people, notoriously casual people, that I have prepared some remarks that are far more eloquent than I can be offhand. I've been a fan of David's my entire career, and actually before I ever had a career. I saw Flirting with Disaster during a dark time. I was 5 years out of film school, and I had yet to have a job in my profession or sell anything or even really finish anything. The film was so funny and alive and related to the people in life that I knew to be true, as well as being filled with new faces and an incredible new energy which moved between voices. It was at once tragic, dramatic, satirical, and straight out funny. Who the hell was this person? Here we are, some years later, and he's just gotten better. As much as I love that he treats me as a peer, I will always be happiest being in his audience. No matter how much David and his work has been an inspiration and a model of how making substantial and original films, like all great masters, his process and effort have been deftly hidden. I try to figure out what he's doing, but I always stop analyzing about 5 shots in. The story and the people take me away, and there's nothing left to do but sit back and feel all the feelings he's putting up there. You have no choice but to feel, and that's why I'm in the movie theater to begin with. So before we begin with any questions, I wanted to thank you with all that, and especially for doing it all again with joy. David O. Russell is on a tear. Since 2010, he has made 4 pictures, The Fighter, Silver Linings Playbook, American Hustle, and now Joy, each stamped with his personal artistic rules, innovative casting, dynamic cinematography, indelible characters, and what seems to be his most steadfast rule, there are no rules. In Joy, David has taken on one of the most difficult subjects, success. He and his cast have become familiar with it clearly and have provided a meditation that goes beyond the traditional 3-act structure of dream, obstacle, and triumph. It is the wonder of the film Joy that it has its moments of victory, but also takes seriously the private and real story of success in David's always original filmic language. The dreams originating in the child's imagination and then the adult miracle of inspiration. The obstacles living in the home and in the heart, and the triumph colored with compromise and forgiveness. So, on that somewhat intellectual note, what's Jennifer Lawrence really like? And how do you say no to her? She's got to be so pretty in person. my first question...
I want to clap for what you just said.
Whatever. I had time to prepare.
No, that was so kind and generous of you, and I have such... My respect is so vast for the magnificent thing you've given our culture, which I can watch repeatedly and repeatedly and act out scenes from, so... I can't begin. Nice. I could do the same. I'm grateful that I have been able to do the same for you.
I'm so in love with this movie. It is so beautiful. I got to see it a second time here tonight, and the control you have over the feeling in it, the darkness and then the lightness, the joy, literally that you feel, the flamenco guitar under the sails thing. You love sails. I wanted to talk first about forgiveness, actually. She never yells at her family. I do it with my family, and they're actually helping me. So clearly, you are attuned to a family that is an obstacle. But forgiveness is part of the story.
Yes, one of the things that made me want to make the film is that the actual Joy who inspired it, about half of it, is a breathtakingly big-spirited person. And when I met her with her... I find that very inspiring.
Yes.
Yeah, so I just find it inspiring. You know, that's, I think I like heroes, you know, and I like anti-heroes, and I like unexpected heroes. So that made, that was part of her being a hero to me.
Interesting. So how do you know the, let me ask you this question. How do you know the difference between what's idiosyncratic and what's universal? It's not an argument that you can win with anyone when you have a thing of like, people are like this because I'm like this. But you really have a sense. I mean, I know that you take this material and a lot of it is influenced by you and the actors in your personal life and you put it in the work. I've heard you talk about that. How do you know what will appeal to everyone? How do you find that?
Well, I don't, you know, I would never presume to say that I do know how to do that. Here's what I do know, and I think it's also true in your work. You have to come from a place that you know that is real. You know, that's, you know, you're made up of the people who surrounded you and the places you knew or where you were able to be near and imagine being. That makes who you are. It's not random. You know, so you have to stay rooted in a world that you can make personal in some way, because that's what makes us all who we are. Are the people we love, the people we struggle with, and with the specificity of them. So all I know is I have to grab onto the specificity, and then I have to love it. I have to love them, including in all their brokenness. And, you know, no one plays a loving father like Robert De Niro, because he's a very soulful, loving man. He's also credibly plays a very limited kind of narcissist or a broken guy, which is heartbreaking. He had a metal garage. That's specific. A little girl. I said, what makes up this little girl's psyche? A metal garage. Her mother's soap opera. A steady, quiet grandmother. For Jennifer and I, it was a new ambition. What's it like to be quietly powerful? We had seen Jennifer be baroque and loud in Silver Linings Playbook and in American Hustle. She comes in and takes over the movie in a very dramatic, loud way. What's it like to be quiet, to be the unanxious presence in the room? And I'd like to tell you where I heard that phrase. An unlikely friend of mine, a friend of mine who was a roommate, went into his family scrap metal business in Buffalo. And he worked there till he was 40. And he picked up the phone one day. There's a hockey player, a big lug of a guy. And he said, I'm going to become a rabbi. And I said,
I said, that's what I said.
I mean, the guy never was a religious person. You know what I'm saying? It was just like, he was like a hockey player. You know what I'm saying? He was a big guy. And I was like, wow. I mean, you're not going to make any money. You're going to go back to some college. Anyway, I went to the installation ceremony. When the old guy gave him the Ark of the Covenant to him, whatever it was, gave him the thing, right?
It's called a diploma.
No, not the diploma.
Oh, really?
No, when he got installed as a rabbi in his own place, right?
Oh, okay.
You know, there's like a term. So he goes, are you prepared to this? Are you prepared to that? All of his responsibilities, which were like really interesting. It was like you were becoming a Jedi, you know? I mean, in a cool way. It was super cool. I thought, I'd never think becoming a rabbi was cool, but it was like, it was cool. And then he goes, the last thing he said, are you prepared to be the unanxious presence in the room? And I thought, oh my goodness.
That's amazing.
That will be John's job. What is that job? So I love that the grandmother was that. And then that she becomes that. And when De Niro said, I really want to meet the real Joy and the father, the first thing out of the father's mouth was, when I made all these inventions, when I created them. And we looked over to Joy to see if it was going to become
she
like,
was going to strangle
if
him.
It was going to become like the Jerry Springer show, yeah. And she didn't, she's the boss, man. I mean, she's Michael Corleone. She just sits there. She loves him. She loves him. She's been sued by him. He lost. she forgives him. And she lets him, she carries the smaller people with her.
You know, you write a character who doesn't talk because it's your fantasy, right? Yes. You're going to go in there and you're going to be in a confrontation. and you're just going to put two fingers on your cheek and listen and then get up and go. And I just like, it's so powerful, right? But I found it, she is the unanxious presence in the room. And I assume a lot of her is what attracted you to it. But
well, Dallas is true. Yeah. She does walk into that room in Dallas. That truly happened.
That's an incredible scene,
by the way. She truly found the goods on that guy by going through documents this thick. She was done. You know, that's what I find. Everybody's done. We're all done 10 times, right? 100 times. We're done. It's over. You got to kind of fake it for as long as you, like, life's okay. But she was done. She went through and she found all the shit. She got the goods on this guy. And then she walked in that room and she had him. She knew he was a dead man. And she walked in. She could just sit there. And, you know, he says to her, you got nothing. You're this. And this scary man. You know, a woman alone in a hotel room, and she seemed so vulnerable for a moment, trying to put her elbow on the shirt. She's like trying to look cool. She's like, you know, and then she goes, "I made a phone call this morning to Hong Kong," and you know when a gangster has you because they're just kind of enjoying taking their time, and they're talking, and she goes, "It was 1 a.m. here, but it was 5 p.m. the next day there." I always find that so interesting how, watch this pause, Jennifer, this is all Jennifer, all pure Jennifer. It's so interesting how time works like that. I mean, to me, that's something I'm going to get off on imitating for the rest of my life. And she takes a step on that line. That's all Jennifer. You know, she goes, let me own this, let me do it how I'm going to do it.
Well, the camera is a big part of expressing that time, but you are great at elongating the moments that matter and finding them. And to think that that woman who was clearly, I'm talking about Jennifer now, incredibly poised beyond her years of experience, and to feel her heart beating when that stage is turning, it's such an incredible shot. That's a moment for me where I am feeling an anxiety, and seeing it for the second time, I was able to sort of like step out of for a second and say, how is that woman figuring out how to, is she ever that nervous anymore? What is she calling on? And you're there. And I love the way you play with time in the movie. I don't think even seeing it a second time that I can figure out where the flashbacks are, where the moments are that are real, where the dream life takes over, what's really happening. And I also am fascinated by the fact that this is such a opportunity for kitsch. It really is. And this is my big question. You have QVC, you got the mop, you have soap operas. All of this could have been treated with a more derisive and crowd-pleasing, actually, on some level. We all like to laugh at that, look how silly people were, whatever. What, I have a theory, but what attracted you to this material?
I'd love to hear your theory first.
First,
yeah.
I think that this is a movie on a meta level involving you and Jennifer Lawrence and Bradley about success and about the fact that you can be a nice person and succeed. That it is possible.
Well, I mean,
No one agrees.
No.
There's a lot of head shaking. You're positive. What if I'm right? Just say I'm
who
right.
Who shook their head?
This guy is Which positive. Guy? The gentleman who looks like me in 3 years, right there, in the gray sweater.
Oh, that
what
guy.
If I'm right?
All right, we can't wait for his question. Or maybe we can. I think that is part of it. I've watched Jennifer and Bradley grow up, in a sense. And I'm the oldest guy. I'm the senior elder person of cinema on our world. And Jennifer was a 20-year-old girl when I met her, who was not famous, and she had Hunger Games had not come out. And you asked, you know, he's speaking of the shot of the rotating stage when Jennifer's just standing, and I fell in love with that stage, which was a detail that I dug out from The Real Joy, that they had a rotating pie stage. That is something that I get off on. That they had a stage that was broken into a garden set, a living room set, a Joan Rivers set, and it would just kind of go.
Did you ever go to Disneyland as a child? They had a thing called I want to say it's called America the Beautiful.
With all the puppet, with all the guys? No.
It was not.
It's the Hall of Presidents.
Yes. And it was a circular stage, and it would go dark, and then it would rotate to the next thing, which was filled with animatronic things. But it was far more magical than a curtain open and closing or anything. You were just like, what's coming, you know? And it would distract you with some guy talking on the side with a spotlight, like a magic show. You'd go over there, and all of a sudden you'd look back, and there'd be a new set there.
But well, I loved it for many reasons. One was I love that she's in the Emerald City and she doesn't know where she is. And I love that the Emerald City is a cable station in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And I loved treating it. I loved not making fun of it. To me, what makes things funny is when you commit to them the way the people who live there commit to them. It wasn't funny to them, man. You know, that they were writing home about it. They're like, I'm doing an exciting new thing, Mom. You know, and I hope it succeeds. You know, and I don't know if it's clear that Barry Diller had left Hollywood when he bought this and was considered a little bit of maybe he had fallen, how the mighty had fallen, because he bought this little cable station. But it turns out he was way ahead of the curve, doing something very risky and brilliant. And I love I'm going to say something about Bradley and Jennifer. It isn't just being nice. It's being fierce and powerful in a way that has love and loyalty in it and grace. And that to me is the mightiest thing of all. That's the baddest ass thing of all to me. That's the ultimate of badasses. When you have magic and people will envy it or try to take it away or want to hate on you, and you can bear it with grace and a sense of humor and not being precious about yourself, and be generous to those around you. Bradley's one of the most generous co-filmmakers I know. As an actor, he's generous to every actor who's working with him. And as a filmmaker, he comes into my editing room. And it's the same thing with Jennifer and Robert. They're all extremely generous people. They're not just about themselves. They're not small people. Robert De Niro is a great model to me for this. He has a gigantic family. He has many businesses he started. And he forbears a lot. If you have any amount of success and you have any love for people, you will be surrounded by many problems. You know, everyone will come to you, and you can either be a prick about it, or you can be someone who has the patience to listen to them, and to love her father, and have the patience to listen, and have your husband work for you. I want to say something else.
I remember when Robert De Niro was in the Genco olive oil business. He managed that family very, very well. Doesn't it? At some point, I know this is totally Chris Farley moment here. Doesn't it blow your mind that guy worked with Bertolucci and Coppola and Scorsese, and he's there in your movie, and he's totally present. He's playing that guy. It must be something you have to forget about when you're working.
He is a magnificent presence, and I fear him and love him. No, but I fear and love Jennifer. I fear and love Bradley. The people you truly love, you must fear, because that's how you treat them with care. And you're extra care. You don't get careless. You know what I'm saying? You treat them like this is to be respected. And I treat it like a vast privilege. And, you know, Robert is an extraordinary human being. And when he shows up, he's meticulous. He's an artist. He's meticulous down to every single thing he wears and what he's going to say, and he has no end of how much he wants to talk about it and figure it out. There was a day where I thought, shouldn't your guy have a necklace? Like, shouldn't we see a little glint of his necklace in this father? Isn't that who he is? He'd have a cross or something in there, right? And you'd catch a glimmer of it, and he's that guy. And Bob goes, yeah. And Vinny, the prop master, who's extraordinary and dedicated, would do anything for us. Vinny Mazzarella in our amazing art department, which, you know, we're four movies deep. Judy Becker has created these worlds, from The Fighter to Silver Linings to American Hustle to this. Many worlds in this world. And the guy goes, it's 10 minutes to the truck. So everybody's like, oh, 10 minutes. So an AD's like, well, let's just shoot some. And so from around the corner, Bob's entering the scene from around the corner, and I can't see him, but this is what I hear. And he gives 1/10 of the lion that he is. Because when you're truly powerful, you don't have to show, you know, when I was younger, famously, sputteringly, I did not know how to own or appropriate power graciously. But I've aspired to learn to do that from the best. I hear him from around the corner go, wait, no, let's not just shoot. And I'm like this. and he comes around and he goes, no, let's not just shoot. Excuse me. I want the necklace. And I go, get the necklace, Vinny. And then everything went silent as a pin. That's a wonderful thing. But I want to tell you another
reason. I want to hear why you attracted to the material.
Okay, all
right,
okay.
So far, I'm right, by the way.
Yes, No. It is about success, but success also has this filled with broken. It's not a cake. It looks like a cake. Everybody thinks, oh, they're on easy street. Once you get there, you got no more problems. You know, I remember, you know, looking up to filmmakers and who got chances and hating them and being envious and, you know, gosh, when I got there. And then you get there and it's never ends. Having to earn it never ends. Having to fight for it never ends. The problems just become different problems.
Terry Winter on The Sopranos would say, when you turn in a script, he'd been there for 5 years when I got there. I go, how'd I do? And he goes, you're only as good as your last envelope, which is the mafia thing.
Yes.
Like,
yes. You're only as good as your last moment. That's what keeps us honest. You have to always remember that it could stink at any moment. So it's handling that graciously, knowing that inside the cake is broken glass and blood and heartbreak and tears. That's what's inside the cake of success. And it asks more of you. It asks you to be a bigger person. It comes great responsibility to be treated with respect. So that's part of me. I've had some success, but I still treat all these people with enormous fear and respect and care. And I wanted to say about the rotating stage again. I was in love with the fact that she'd be walking around the rotating stage, and all of a sudden, there'd be a dog. And this is an absolutely true story, that there was a sign that said, watch out for Joan's dogs. Don't let Joan's dogs get caught under the stage when it moves. And then we have this road where I love moments. These are cinema magic to me as a director. They're walking in the dark. She's going deeper and deeper into the Oz of Bradley Cooper's MGM that he treats so seriously. And he had meanwhile grown up through Clint Eastwood and lost all of his boyhood. He'd become sort of a man, and that's how we did the role. Mm-hmm. Like the salesman colleagues of my father. And she goes,
he is a different person since that movie. You could feel it. It's also good to be getting older too.
Yes, it's age. And Jennifer being nervous when the stage rotates around, you should never mistake her success, anybody's success, for a lack of fear and vulnerability and humanness. She is as vulnerable and human as anybody. And she's as nervous about doing anything. Like Robert Zimmerman said, every time he goes on stage, he's scared. And if you're not scared, you shouldn't do it anymore. You know, it's a healthy fear. It means you're going to jump off a cliff and it's scary. And she can access that in a second because she feels it every day. You know, one minute she seems like a 45-year-old boss who's going to, you know, who's going to tell me what's what. And the next day she seems like a kid, you know, who's filled with vulnerability and shakiness and says, tell me why I'm any good. Tell me why you like me. You know what I'm saying? Tell me, David, tell me something beautiful. I also love that as the stage is rotating, she picks up this dog. And then all of a sudden, this wall turns into Joan Rivers in a living room who just takes the dog, you know. And it's like, you know, and that's how that stage works. That's enough of the stage, I guess. Here's one more thing I loved about the stage. Because the movie, you mentioned shadow and light. This movie cinematically was the most ambitious for me in terms of how we framed it in a more classic 40s, 50s way, how we used shadow and silhouettes and light. Silhouettes are the doorway to the soul. So if a little girl's in a silhouette with her grandmother who's telling her your life's going to be okay, there's something that feels timeless about that to me. We were trying to create magic that's unattainable, but by reaching for it, you get some of it. And that you must always reach for something that's unattainable. It's in your mind. It's beyond human capacity. It's divine in some way. But by reaching for it, we get a little bit of it. And we got that. And then the girl stands up in silhouette, and it's Jennifer Lawrence in silhouette. And 20 years have passed, 17 years have passed. That was breathtaking to me to play with time on that level. And shadow and light are, when you rotate on the stage, you're like, I was just explaining to my four-year-old today, he said, why does nighttime happen? And I was explaining how, I go, look, that's the light, look, it's going to go around. Now it's dark over here. So you'd see Jennifer rotating, especially at the end when she had her hands together and she's in her 40s and she's rotating. She's like, it's pitch black. Then the sun is kind of slowly breaking across her, you know, as she's rotating. It's just, to me, that was.
I think it also draws you in. There's a lot of moments in the I thought the way Virginia Madsen, there's so many people to talk about in terms of their performances. Virginia Madsen was incredible to me. She's obviously, I've seen her since I saw her at a party, and she's still kind of a sex symbol. And it's amazing to imagine that at any point in time, those glasses were considered a fashion accessory, which they were. They were. Beautiful woman. You know, there was definitely probably some incredible model wearing them on a magazine. But the way that you shot that bedroom, and it reminded me of like Repulsion or something. I had no idea what size it was. It is very comforting and warm and small at points. Talk about classic. And at some points, like when Robert De Niro comes in, you have no idea how big it is. You have no idea what size it is. You don't know where you are. Things fall on the floor. It gets messier and messier and messier. There's like a scary half of it and a comforting half of it. And she, who is so small in the other places in the movie, is really occupies that space. And I always feel like it's a treat, Isabella Rossellini, it's a treat to see people who are incredibly gifted and you don't see them that much anymore. And I don't know if it's just that you're writing parts for women that are in that age range and you get to bring in everybody who's been amazing in the last 20 years, or is it something you're thinking about when you're writing?
Starting with the fighter, women have become increasingly inspiring to me. And Isabella Rossellini is someone I've waited to work for my whole life, you know, since I saw Blue Velvet and those L'Oreal ads or whatever those ads were. And she's perfect because the girlfriend is the banker that made it possible. That's in the true story. You want to live your dream, you got to go through her. That's the banker. You got to get somebody who's going to bank you, right? There was no kickstart, and sometimes even kickstart doesn't work. So the fact that she was foreign, there's no one like her. Absolutely no one like her. Who's charming and continental and magical and romantic and also fierce and horrifying. Diane Ladd. I've waited my whole life to work with Diane Ladd.
Yeah, she's really incredible. It's incredible when you see somebody who can completely draw your attention in a crowd of those people, too, without shifting focus or anything.
She's a powerful presence.
She feels like a ghost the whole movie.
Yes.
You know?
She is.
I mean,
like
even
that.
When she's alive,
she's hovering around.
No one's
around.
Listening to her.
Yes, she's a presence. And my grandmother's like that. They're there, and when they're gone, you're aware that they're gone, but you feel like they're still there. And that's a very special dimension of a home to me, to have that level of a person. And Edgar Ramirez, who I'd only known as playing a terrorist in Carlos,
right.
Who's got a very scary face. Every time he'd make that face, I'd go, Edgar, that's too scary, that face. You know, I mean, all his resting face is a scary face. Which is an amazing thing, because he can look like this man from Venezuela, you know, and then he can be so gentle and loving and a strong enough man to work for his ex-wife. That's a strong man.
Was that really their relationship? There's
That's
so many
true.
Things that, and he
That's
really
true.
Lived in the basement with her father.
Yes,
Renette.
He lived in the basement. He could have done it forever. It worked out great for him. He got to be, he didn't have to get his own place. He could sing down there. He didn't have to get a job, you know. I mean, those are how some, you know, that's who he was. She married him because he was magical, you know. And I'd been waiting 40 years to use those songs that they sing, The Waters of March.
I love that song.
And Something Stupid.
Something Stupid, yeah.
And to have the Nat King Cole song, which we choreographed the shots to that song with that introduction he did on the radio, which is very hard to find online. Yes, sir, tonight's the night when all the kiddies and grown-ups across the land wait for Santa Claus to come. Let's look at a house. As she's arriving at the toy store, about to look back on her entire past, having just made her bones as a made man, and she looks back with tenderness at this train set she never had and these sled and the father she never had. He goes, Mr. Santa Claus, can we have a little snow, please? And I thought snow was such a recurring metaphor of magic and timelessness in our film, that it was somehow appropriate that it was artificial snow. But for her, it became a very magical moment, like she was in her own snow globe, reflecting upon her entire life. And he says, and how about a house with love in it? Maybe we can put some love in this house. And then you go to her house that does have love in it. even with her father who sued her, even with her ex, even with her ex-husband who works for her.
That's beautiful. There are so many moments where the music takes over, and we've talked about this, when it's just like a chemical rush of, you know, her in that, just starting backstage with something stupid, starting with them talking in the closet, and then going onto the backstage and her beckoning on the stage and her singing. There's just moments like that that you can't put the feeling of it into words. And I felt actually the same way about that moment with her watching the first sales thing at QVC with the flamenco guitar in it. It's just like exhilarating. And also at the end with the Nat King Cole thing, there's you. It's an opportunity to just like completely change the picture, right? I mean, do you try different things? You're saying you wrote around with this Nat King Cole thing. You wrote that to it. Everything else, you obviously have to pick something stupid and decide they're going to do that scene because they're going to sing it. But do you experiment a lot with things? I mean, it's so radically different. You never know if it's going to work until you put it up against the picture.
Yes, that's true.
And you have also masterfully done this in your series, and I'm always acting out sequences from your series where you use the Vanilla Fudge's version of Keep Me Hanging On to end Don Draper's season where he's alone on the veranda. You just keep me hanging. But it's super slow motion compared to Diana Ross's version, and it's just heartbreaking. I mean, that's...
Sometimes you find a weird version of something.
That's the best.
Yeah. I saw the first director I ever saw who had any talent was in... I was in a play in college, and they were doing Waiting for Godot, and he was a experienced director who had come back to teach at the college, and he used a version of Zippity Doo Dah that Phil Spector did with the Ronettes or one of his groups that is so slow and so sad. And you're like, who thought of doing this? But it's still Zippity Doo Dah, and it almost like it plays against the version in your head, like jazz does. It's like you have the version in your head, and then you're hearing this, and it's going against it. It's a beautiful movie.
Oh, wait, they're giving you a signal.
Yeah.
Let me say this.
Yeah.
Some of the songs are songs I've been waiting 30, I'm old enough to say, 30 to 40 years to use. Neil Young's from Buffalo Springfield, Expecting to Fly, is as an orchestra, or I'm probably the only person in this room who knows what it is. Everybody's like, what's Buffalo Springfield? So... it has an orchestral cinematic beginning.
It's a strip club, isn't it?
That begins when she finds out her grandmother's dead, and it goes... it's an orchestra getting louder and louder. Neil Young started with an orchestra, and it's such beautiful lyrics that carries you all the way through the funeral. There you stood on the edge of your feather, expecting to fly. I tried so hard not to fall as I stumbled and fell to the ground. With this beautiful melody. I've been waiting for that, Waters of March. Some things we found, the Prokofiev by Cinderella that the little girls make their paper forest to, getting Brittany Howard from the Alabama Shakes.
Do I Feel Free.
To Do I Feel Free, which Jack Bruce and Eric Clapton sang. And you always want to find things that haven't been used. You know, and that's an a cappella thing Eric Clapton did with Jack Bruce. Ba 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 da ba 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 da, I feel free. And you know, it's just very beautiful. And then Brittany Howard, this magnificent African American singer from Alabama, who did a song for us in Silver Linings, did that a cappella version, overdubbing herself at the end.
Oh wow!
I thought it was appropriate that it become a woman singing it at the end, and that it was a cappella.
Well, it's a beautiful movie. Your style is evolving. You are constantly challenging yourself, and people often, I think this, believe it or not, might be Malcolm Gladwell who said this, but something that people often respond to things that are new by saying that they don't understand them or don't like them or whatever. And we get scared sometimes because of that. And I feel like there is so much new in this movie. And other than, as I told you, these four movies having the metal slamming screen door in all of them, which we all recognize from our home, your style is just evolving, and the stories are so different from each other. And this was a dreamy and thoughtful and emotional experience for me, and I think for everybody here. So I'm very happy that you made it. And Jennifer Lawrence has her ability to hold my attention while she's thinking is something that you took complete advantage of, and her transformation of the story. I have no idea how old she is. I don't know what it is, but you the two of you together, it's a very powerful thing. So thank you for that.
Thanks, man.
Was it a struggle for you because Joy is not as flawed and effed up as some of your previous characters?
Well, to me, it's a different kind of flawed and a different kind of fucked up. Because if you're magical, or you have magic or power inside of you, or music in you, but you're not living it, and you're letting other people define your world, and you've become their puppet, and you've still abandoned the garden that God gave you, you know. So there's some way she's living a profoundly dishonest. She's not a saint. She's someone who has a good heart, but who's not. You know, you might say to her, well, if she's probably thought, if I dare to break free from my family, that would be letting them down. But in fact, the opposite is true. So often with smaller people, when you dare to become who you're truly meant to be is when the whole thing gets bigger, and even they get bigger and more. So to me, she was tragically flawed in her weakness in the first half of the film. There was something very weak, and sort of her wings were clipped, you know, and she just seemed like it's what a boss said to me when I had my first PA job, which was me sitting frozen in a production meeting, just lost in my mind, like sitting there daydreaming, scared. And he said, I feel like you're an outboard motor waiting to be started, you know. And that's how you feel about Joy in the first half of the movie, like she's an outboard motor waiting to be started. And then once it gets started, then you can feel all the octane kick in. And that, yeah.
It's amazing that those four questions, those business questions, are amazing. I don't know if they're really, were they really Morris's questions or not? Because I feel like the character is defined in that moment when they talk about, they ask her about being the valedictorian. And it is all of our greatest fear and the story, the warning story that we hear from people who did not get what they wanted in life, that they took no for an answer. And it is a huge flaw, and you feel it in that moment. Are those real questions, or did you make those up?
No. I just love what you just said. No, you can very, without even realizing it. You know, the question in American Hustle was, you need to even con yourself to get through the day. Sometimes you need to fake it till you make it. And sometimes that's a legitimate way to live. I just gotta hang in there, and I gotta tell myself a story about this, so I can get through it. Like Winston Churchill saying, I had to believe I was an optimist during the darkest days of the war, because if I couldn't afford to do the other thing. So he had to pretend to be more optimistic than he was, or England would have been taken over by Germany. So that's lying to himself. In this movie, there's accepting no for an answer. And it can happen without you even realizing it's happened to you. You wake up in a marriage and you're like, what am I doing in this marriage? Have I said no to myself? Have I said no to life? Those are hard questions.
Her thing on the phone saying, I want another chance. I want to do it. And it's so quiet. And it's the turning point in the movie, obviously, even more than anything.
Well, that's when she first says, well, I can't accept your answer.
I can't accept your answer.
I can't and I won't. And it's just like
she can barely say it.
Yes. Her voice is so quiet because she's never said that to anybody in the movie in her life.
Yeah. It's not as sexy a flaw, but it's a lot more identifiable
it's
to
true.
Me anyway.
It's true. It's true.
Yes, in
it's
the
a
back.
More mature. This movie was about adult concerns, and not craziness, a different. You know what I'm saying? So yeah.
The question is: there's a written, directed, and edited version of a film, and for you, is it the same on every film?
No. Every time. That's what makes it so harrowing. That's why I'm starting to have gray hair around my ears. No, I mean, as somebody, you know, this director Todd Solondz, this art director, is probably. I mean, I was on a panel with him once, and he had such a distinctive voice. He talked like this,
yeah.
And he said, "Well, every film takes 10 years off your life, so what's the difference?" is a New Yorker, but I mean, no, every film is an adventure where you've put yourself in a pickle, you put yourself in trouble. By you could say that about. Alfonso Cuarón when he decided to make that space movie, or Ang Lee when he decided to make that raft movie. I call it the Tiger on the Raft movie. You know, I mean, Or when I decide to make a movie about it, it's all about a guy who moved back home with his parents. Or it's about a lady who made a mop, you know? And everybody's like, really? I can't wait to see this, you know? And you're like, well, you've really put yourself in a pickle now, dude. You know, now you've got to make it live and make it rich and make it deep. And you've put yourself in a predicament. And then that's it's the joy of art is meeting that challenge that's scary to you. The Citizen Kane thing to me, of course, was a film that I thought about because I like reflecting upon success in the price you pay for it. And that's why I liked having that Bruce Springsteen thing that he was kind enough to let us make a very quiet instrumental version of Racing in the Streets. That's what that song feels like to me, played quietly on the piano. So the Citizen Kane thing to me is that there's heartbreak at the end, but joy is actually a bigger spirit than that. She's not as damaged and as wantonly greedy or out of, you know, she's not as much of a catastrophe as Charles Foster Kane was. Charles Foster Kane became a demagogue. You know, she just tried to live this dream for herself and then had to tolerate all the guts it took out of her. And the fact that she'd lost 17 years of her life, that was a metaphor I was waiting 40 years to use.
The cicada, that was great. Cicadas are really mysterious and creepy, right?
Yeah, so I mean, but it works perfect. Where have you been for the last 17 years of your life? I've had that moment.
You've made 4 movies since 2010. That is, I don't believe that is not driven by an impatient energy and in sales.
I don't know what that means in sales, but what it means to
me is that you have to go. It's hard for people to get movies made, and you've done something incredible.
Well, it's hard to make movies that are about people and their emotions that actually reach a wide audience. That's become a very narrow landing strip, and we've done it, 3 times, and I hope we can
do it
this time. But there's the joy moment when you decide you're going to turn that corner. And you're not going to be as patient. You're going to become fierce, and you're going to learn to say no, and you're going to say yes. The dance of a director is he will do anything for a movie, but he must choose the moments to say no and to say please, this must happen, and the moments to back off. You have to choose those very carefully. And my answer to your question is you treat what you're doing with enormous gratitude and respect and humility because you realize you're so lucky. And it could be taken away at any time. And it's not, you haven't, just because you've made a good movie or two, or it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything. It doesn't make you better than anybody. It just means you're just like anybody else. And now you have to try to do it again. And it's just as hard as it was the first time. You know, it's very hard to make a good movie. And so I just feel like Jimmy Stewart at the end of It's a Wonderful Life, when you look back on all this stuff and you look all the pain and the heartbreak and you say, I say yes. I say yes to life. When 5 minutes ago I was going to jump off a bridge, I was going to say no, but I say yes. That's an act of tremendous courage that everybody has to do. That my Uncle Andrew, who worked on building the tunnels out of New York to New Jersey, you know, he had to do that. He had to say yes to life, and he got emphysema, you know, from breathing in all those sand hogs. They called them sand hogs. He said yes, and he had a gleam in his eye when I knew him as a young boy, and that was something he passed on to me. So, I don't know. I think it's a nice note to end on.
It's excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you so much, David. Thanks for the movie.